Why are there so many insect species? This presentation was first given as a Darwin Day lecture in February 2018. This presentation is for educational purposes only and is non-for-profit. Because this is a Darwin Day lecture, I want to start by making reference to some of the things that Darwin had to say about insects. And Darwin had quite a lot to say about insects in some parts of his life. He wrote a whole book later in his life about the pollination of flowers, and that talked a lot about pollinating insects. But much earlier in his life, he was especially when he was a student at Cambridge, a theology student as it turns out, he was a very avid beetle collector. And we have a letter from Darwin to one of his relatives complaining that he doesn't have enough people to talk about insects, not rather surprising given that he was supposed to be studying theology at the time. Later in his life, Darwin recalled an incident when he was writing his autobiography of some of these beetle collecting trips that he went on when he was at Cambridge. And he recalled this incident when he saw two rare beetles at once, and then all of a sudden found a third one, which he couldn't bear to lose. So he popped one of the beetles that he was already holding into his mouth, and unfortunately it ejected some foul defense fluid that made him spit it out. So as a result, he lost the other beetle he was trying to collect as well. Now, Darwin was a very good all-round naturalist and studied lots of different groups of organisms later on. But I suppose in terms of the question that I'm going to answer, it's not a question he directly addressed, but what he did do, of course, is give us the tools that we need as evolutionary biologists to address why there are so many insect species. And one of these tools, which I'll talk a bit about in a later slide, is something called the evolutionary tree, or the tree of life. And that turns out to be a very important tool that we can use to address why some groups of organisms are diverse and that others are not. Before I go on to the main question of this presentation, I just want to give you an introduction to some of the types of insects and say something about their biology, because this becomes very important later on. So the earliest insects, those that we would describe as basal in the evolutionary tree of insects, and which appear earliest in the fossil record, are wingless, primitively wingless insects. And they include actually hexapods, six-legged arthropods, which are not technically insects, such as the springtails here. Their relatives, the Diplura, and a much less well-known group, the Protura. And all of these are not true insects because their mouthparts are internal rather than external, as they are in true insects. And Columbella, the springtails, appear about 410 million years ago in the fossil record, actually, from Rhynie in Scotland. There are also true insects which are primitively wingless, such as silverfish here, which are very familiar to people, and they live in homes, very common in those homes, and bristletails, which are soil-dwelling organisms. All of these types of primitively wingless hexapods live in soil and feed on detritus or sometimes fungi. There's then a gap in the fossil record of insects until about 350 million years ago, the Carboniferous period, in which coal deposits were laid down. And at that point we get large numbers of winged insects for the first time, including the most primitive group of winged insects, the Paleoptera, which are unable to fold their wings flat over their backs. Modern groups that are Paleopterous include the dragonflies and damselflies, Odonata, and they have about 5,000 living species. And the mayflies, Ephemeroptera, which is slightly less species rich. But in the fossil record, there are a number of groups that went extinct, which also couldn't fold their wings flat over their backs, including these fossil so-called Paleodictyoptera, which were beaked insects. This specimen here is in the Naturalist Museum. It's another Scottish specimen. At the same time that we get Paleopterous insects in the fossil record, we also find another group known as the Polyneoptera. And unlike the Paleoptera, these insects have evolved the ability to fold their wings flat over their backs. Very early on in their evolution, we find cockroach-like organisms like this one, and they have left descendants which include the true cockroaches themselves, the praying mantises, which are just really a predatory group of cockroaches, and also a group of social cockroaches, which we know today as the termites. Also in the Polyneoptera are other organisms which are very diverse and very familiar to us, such as the grasshoppers and crickets, the Orthoptera. Other Polyneoptera which are familiar to most people include the earwigs, and here you can see an earwig which has grasped a prey item, which is in fact another Polyneoptera and a cricket, in its pincers here at the end of its abdomen, and it's about to predate that. There are a number of other so-called orders of insects within the Polyneoptera, most of which are less familiar to people, but which do include this group, which are familiar to anglers, because these are the stoneflies, the Plecoptera, and their larvae are aquatic. So the next group to appear after the Paleoptera and the Polyneoptera are the Paraneoptera. And the Paraneoptera are like the Polyneoptera in that they can fold their wings over their backs, but they also don't have a true metamorphosis that hadn't evolved in these groups yet. And there are only three main groups of Paraneopterous insects. They all tend to have piercing and sucking mouthparts. So they include the true bugs, such as aphids and cicadas and shield bugs, and they're very species rich. Another group that's less familiar to people are the thrips or thunderflies, which are small insects that mostly feed on plants, but not all of them. And they are often very common in northern hemisphere summer, where they gather in on window panes. And then there are the bark lice and the true lice, which have become parasitic. So finally, the most derived groups of insects are those which have a true metamorphosis, a true pupal stage, which distinguishes the larva from the adult. And four groups of insects with metamorphosis, the so-called holometabola, have evolved over 100,000 species that have been described. So they include the true flies, the Diptera, the wasps, bees, ants, and their Phytophagous relatives, the sawflies, the very species-rich butterflies and moths, Lepidoptera, and then the absurdly species-rich beetles, the Coleoptera, and there are about 350,000 described species. Other groups of insects which have metamorphosis include the fleas and the lacewings. So here you can see a picture of a landscape on planet Earth with lots of living organisms, and you can see there's something funny about this picture. And the thing that's funny about it is that the organisms are all the wrong size relative to each other. We've got a very large beetle here representing the insects. We've got a very large mite representing other arthropods, but we've got a tiny elephant and an enormous fungus, and so on. And you might ask what the size represents in this picture, and of course it represents the number of species that there are approximately in these different taxonomic groups, or at least the number of species that have been described. So a better way of looking at the species richness of living organisms is to plot them as a pie chart, like you see here. And there's about 1.5 million described species currently, although there is no single definitive catalogue of described species, though hopefully that's going to change soon. And you can see that over half of them are insects, over 900,000. Quite a lot of the rest are other arthropods that are related to insects, including spiders and crustaceans and centipedes. Then there's a large number of flowering plants and other non-flowering vascular plants. The vertebrates and their kin, the chordates, make up this rather small segment here, 43,000 described species. And then there's various sundry other animals and more microscopic organisms. So this large segment of the pie of life, as we might describe it, made up by insects, has led some rather famous quotations by evolutionary biologists. So the British biologist J.B.S. Haldane, who was one of the architects of the synthesis between genetics and evolution that occurred in the middle of the 20th century, was once asked what he had learned about the mind of the creator from his study of biology. And somewhat facetiously, he is supposed to have replied that the creator had an inordinate fondness for beetles. This is a somewhat sarcastic remark from J.B.S. Haldane, who was a non-believer, a humanist. But it does outline the fondness that, were such a creator to exist, must have for beetles, and indeed, in fact, they would have to be very fond of astronomy as well. Robert May, who's British government chief scientist and president of the Royal Society, famously said that to a close approximation, all species are insects, because ecologists and evolutionary biologists like to deal with round numbers. So if approximately 55 or 60% of described species are insects, you can just round up 55% to 100%, and you're about right. So why do we bother asking why there are so many insect species? I think it's basically, for me, it's because insects are a challenge to our understanding of the universe. They're a very obvious feature of our planet, and if we don't understand why there are so many, then that sits there as a glaring omission in our knowledge. So partly we've got to answer this question, because if we haven't, we look rather silly. But along the way, I think we're going to learn something useful, because we will learn about the processes that generate extreme variation in biodiversity, and that's got to be useful knowledge when we sit in view of ourselves as stewards of the planet, and we have the power to create a world that's either biodiverse or not. Knowing how that diversity has come to be, and knowing how it's so variable across taxonomic groups, is going to really inform us, I think, about how we can manage the planet appropriately. So, well, just a word of caution though, because the number of described species that I've been talking about so far may bear relatively little resemblance to the true number of species. So if there are about 1.5 million described species, well, people, scientists dispute a lot what the true number of species on Earth might be. But one recent study has suggested that the true number of species on Earth might be extraordinarily large, much, much larger than the number of described species, and it may lie somewhere between 1 and 10 billion species. And that suggestion is based largely on work in which people have tried to extract all the DNA from insects, and found that When you do that, some of the DNA that you extract from insects is not actually insect DNA. It belongs to other animals and other organisms that live in or on insects. Generally, these are parasites or pathogens of insects. And if you discover, as people have, that each insect species has a very large number of bacteria that are unique to each insect, and that's of course something we're familiar with ourselves. We are also infected by bacteria that are unique to humans, and it's true of other parasites that infect us. That also appears to be true of insects. That means that the number of bacteria has got to at least be some multiple of the number of insect species. Add to that the fact that some of the parasites of insects are other animal groups. Some of them are mites, for example. Some of them are nematodes. Then the number of animals increases a lot as well, the number of animal species. Some of the parasites of insects are microsporidian fungi, and some of them are protists, protozoans. So when you look at it that way, the species richness of the planet is much, much larger, or would be much, much larger, and it would be almost entirely comprised of parasites and pathogens of insects. And you can see what a tiny fraction, therefore, is actually taken up by plants now. This doesn't mean that our basic question isn't important, because explaining all that richness relies on an understanding of why there are so many insects that can be infected by all these specialized parasites and pathogens. But it is a cautionary, humbling story. Okay, so if we want to understand why there are so many insect species, then it's useful to do a little thought experiment to work out what we need to know. So here's a hypothetical tank of fluid with some nutrients in it, and we're going to throw a hypothetical bacterium into that. And we can ask the question, what's going to happen to the population size of bacteria? And immediately you're probably going to shout out, I can hear you shouting out, that the population is going to grow. So it might look like that. And eventually, of course, it's going to stop growing, because there's not unlimited resources in there for the bacteria to grow on. So we're probably going to see the bacterial population grow and eventually level off, and then something else might happen to it after that. So that's really useful, because it immediately tells us some of the factors that can affect population size of bacteria at any one time. So if we want to explain the population size at any one time, we're going to know how long the population has been there. We also want to know how rapidly bacteria give birth to new bacteria and how quickly bacteria die. And we also want to know what's the maximum number of bacteria that can be sustained in this tank. Now, why are we thinking about bacteria in a tank? Well, this is an analogy for what's happening to species richness on the planet, because we can take the tank as analogous to planet Earth, and this initial bacterium as the ancestor of a group of diversifying organisms, and the bacteria grow by dividing into two, just like species multiply up by giving rise to new species. And then the bacteria die off, and that's analogous to species going extinct. So we have in this set of four factors here, the four factors we need to know about in order to explain the species richness of any group of organisms at any point in time. That includes our insects. And we call a group of organisms that diversify from a common ancestor, single common ancestor, a clade of organisms. So in general, we can say that the factors immediately affecting the species richness of a clade is going to depend on how old the clade is, how long it's had to diversify, how rapidly species give rise to new species. You could call that the birth rate of species, or the speciation rate. How rapidly species go extinct, or the death rate of species. And we want to know whether this clade might be limited in the number of species that can be supported on Earth, where there's a sort of maximum that can be sustained on a planet. So how that looks like diagrammatically might be represented by this branching tree, in which our single ancestral species branches into two, gives rise to a speciation event, and now we've got two species, and there was another speciation event giving rise to a third species, but this species actually goes extinct, dies. And there's another speciation event here, and that species dies, but these other species that arise later on, they survive to the present day. And so if we want to explain species richness of this group at any point in time, we need to know all these four things, really. So that's really useful, because if we want to explain a pattern about the species richness of a group, like insects, then we can immediately refer to those four factors that we've just outlined, and that's going to be very helpful. And in this scheme here, I've called those four factors proximate factors. But ultimately, we need to know something more, because the speciation rate, the extinction rate, the carrying capacity, all these things are the way they are because of something else, some other feature of the group we're interested in. And it may have to do with the way the group is put together and structured, and things to do with the morphology of the group. It may have something to do with the behavior and the way the group interacts with its environment, both other species and the abiotic and the physical environment. When people have historically tried to explain the species richness of insects, they've come up with lots of hypotheses, most of which refer to these what I call ultimate factors. These are features of the biology and ecology of insects and the way the insects are put together that largely are going to work through altering the speciation rate, the extinction rate, and the degree to which the environment can carry different numbers of species. So this is the scheme we're going to use when we're going to try and answer this question from now on. So how can we get information that's going to help us answer our question? One source of information is to look at the fossil record of insects. That enables us to look back in time and see how the richness, the extinctions, and the originations of groups have varied. And as well as all the amber fossils that I've shown you earlier in some slides, there are compression fossils of insects in which insects have died, normally in lake or lagoon-like situations, sunk to the bottom of the lake or lagoon, and being covered immediately with fine sediment, which has compressed them. And that leaves an impression which enables you to identify which broad groups of insects these fossils belong to. So often these insects are able to be put into what we call families of insect species, closely related species. There are about 1,100 living families of insects, and in the fossil record there are about 1,500. So what we can then do is, for each family of insects, we can see at what point in the geological record, at what stage in time, each family first appears, last appears, and therefore how it ranges through geological time. And we can do that for several other families, and once we've done that for a lot of families, we can very easily total up how the species, or family richness in this case, of insects has varied through the times in which we have data. So that's quite useful. And another thing we can do is plot the first appearances, which are originations, and the last appearances, which are extinctions through time. So using that, we can see how origination, extinction, and richness vary across taxonomic groups through time. And that's useful information, because those are pieces of data that help us to answer questions about these proximate factors that we were talking about earlier on. So another source of information are evolutionary trees. So evolutionary trees were a tool given to us by Charles Darwin, who first published a picture of one in The Origin of Species. And today we work out the relationships between modern groups of organisms by largely comparing their DNA sequences. This has been achieved relatively recently for the broad groups of insects, only relatively recently in 2014, in which complete genome sequences of a large number of insects have been achieved, gathered and analysed. These trees tell us who's most closely related to whom, and that's really useful. And if you can date the branching events in these trees, like this one for example, you can date that, amongst other things, by calibrating the branches of the tree with fossil information. Then you can tell when the branching events, speciation events that you're interested in, have occurred through time. So as well as seeing when speciation has happened through time and across taxa, you can also plot the number of branches at various points in time to estimate how richness looked in the past. So that's just the top part of this tree. The bottom half fits only on another slide. So to complement the fossil record, we have evolutionary trees of living organisms that we largely construct with molecular data, but which are calibrated in time by using fossil information. So having said all that, we can imagine what our ideal data set or tool set would be for answering the question about why there are so many insects. And that the ideal set of information would be a complete set of fossils and a complete known set of relationships of all insect species that have ever lived. And if we had that, we would know where all the speciation events and all the extinction events, and we would know perfectly how richness varied through time. So we'd have all the information we need for proximate analyses. And if we know a lot of things about these different species, then we also know everything that might tell us about the ultimate variables that affect those proximate variables. So that's the ideal tool set. Now, rather unfortunately, the actual tool set we have is rather inferior to that ideal tool set. So although we do have a fossil record of insects, this is only usable really at the family level, with one or two exceptions. So that means we can't make statements, broad statements, at the species level for insects using the fossil record alone. And unfortunately as well, for many of the families of fossil insects, we don't know how they're related to other insect families very well, because not enough characters have been preserved in most of them to allow a detailed analysis of that. So the alternative source of information, or the complementary source of information, is to look at evolutionary trees of living insects. And here, of course, the trouble is that they're incomplete, because there are so many species of insects, we're probably never going to have a complete evolutionary tree of all of them, not even all of all the species that we've described. So that's also going to be a less than perfect data set. We do, however, know something about how the different families and higher taxa of insects vary in their species richness, and we do know something about other characteristics of those different groups of insects are. So we can make some attempt at ultimate analyses. And rather usefully, though, people have started to develop analytical techniques that can handle these incomplete data sets. So we can gather something from them. And the reason it's rather interesting time to be talking about these types of analyses is that we have much better tools now than we had only a decade ago. So the fossil record of insects is now much, much more complete than it was even a decade ago. And that's just because large numbers of scientists are describing lots of fossil insects at the moment. The genomic revolution especially, but combined with increased computational power, is enabling us to better resolve evolutionary trees of the living insects. Of course, we are getting more and more data on species richness and the other characteristics of these insect groups, but also the computational revolution has increased our ability to apply intensive computational techniques to statistical analysis, and that's enhanced our ability to say something with these data. So the comparison between the ideal data set and the actual data set and the tools we have is a sobering one, and it means that we can't expect to have precise, fully complete answers to the questions we want to answer. I'm reminded by this quote from the theoretical physicist Lawrence Krauss. What he's doing here is referring to the fact that at some point in the future, a few billion years into the future, all evidence for the Big Bang will have disappeared, and then therefore cosmologists of the far distant future will look at the universe and they'll assume that it's always been the way it looks to them. In other words, they'll come to the completely wrong conclusion that the universe has always been static. And I feel like we're in a very similar situation with regard to explaining the species richness of diverse groups, because the observational and theoretical tools at our disposal fall far short of what we would like. And therefore we need to be a bit humble about our conclusions and realize that whatever word we have on these questions is not going to be the last one. So let's just see what some of the recent studies on this question have actually brought to light. So a basic question you can ask about the proximate factors affecting insect species richness is whether they're species rich because they're old, or whether they're species rich because they've been diversifying rapidly. And the net diversification rate that I refer to here is simply the difference between the speciation and the extinction rate. So you can answer that question in principle very, very simply by simply correlating species richness with age or diversification. So in this study, the authors have tried to correlate diversification rate against the richness of different groups of organisms. And the groups of organisms are of a similar type, meaning that they're at the same level in the hierarchy of life. So this bottom graph refers to comparisons of different phyla. These are animals or other organisms with the same body plan. And the top graph refers to smaller, more recently evolved subgroups of those, which we call orders. And on the x-axis of each of these graphs is the diversification rate, which is simply estimated from the age and the current species richness of the group. So when you know the age and the current species richness, it's very straightforward to ask at what rate have those species been formed since the group first originated. And on the y-axis is the logarithm of the species richness of the group. And you can see that in both of these graphs, diversification rate is positively correlated with species richness. There is the slope. And this value here, the r-squared, shows that 72% of the variation in richness is explained by diversification rate in each of these graphs. So diversification rate in general seems to explain variation in species richness much better than the age of different groups of equivalent taxonomic status. Where are the insects in all this? Well, in the lower graph, the insects belong to this data point here at the top, the arthropoda, and they're the most species rich phylum, and they're also a phylum, you'll see, that has a very high diversification rate on average. So that's fine, they fit the trend pretty well. An interesting feature to note of the top graph, which compares subgroups of insects, the so-called orders, as well as subgroups of other groups of living things, is that the most rich insect orders are at the very top of the graph here. So there's the beetles, here are the butterflies and moths, here are the bees, ants, wasps, ants and sawflies, the Hymenoptera. And you can see that they are groups that have a very high richness, but they don't have an astonishingly high diversification rate. So these stand in contrast to the broad trend. And in fact, you can see that all three data points are quite a long way from the average trend line. So these are groups which have got more species than you would expect given their diversification rate, and the only way you can achieve that is if they've been diversifying at those slower rates for a longer time period than is average for these other orders of living things. So another question we can ask about proximate factors is, well, given that we know net diversification rate is important, is that because of a high speciation rate, or is it due to a low extinction rate, or some combination of these two things? So is the rate that we're seeing across groups driven by speciation, or is it driven by extinction, or is it driven by both? Now the fossil record is a very good way of teasing apart those possibilities, because there we have direct observations of first appearances and last appearances of groups, but remembering that these are whole groups, normally families of insects rather than species. Well, this is a study by David Nicholson, a PhD student of mine, in which he compiled all the data for the fossil record of insects, the first and last appearances, up until 2009. And he separated the insects into the different broad groups that I referred to earlier. So at the top here we've got the primitively wingless insects, at the bottom here we've got the derived insects with metamorphosis, and in between we have the other groups I referred to. And on these graphs are drawn two different lines. The solid line tells you the rate of origination of these different groups, and the dotted line is the extinction rate. So a few things to note are that in the primitively wingless insects, both origination and extinction rates are very low, and that's not surprising. They haven't given rise to much diversity. In the primitively winged insects, which can't fold their wings, both the origination rate and the extinction rate are higher than their direct ancestors. So we would describe this as being a group which has a high turnover, taxonomic turnover, and we would expect to see the groups of Palaeopterus insects, which dominate the planet, change a lot as a result of that. And interestingly, here we actually see the extinction rate sometimes temporarily being higher than the origination rate, and that implies that the group started to decrease in diversity at that point. When we move from Palaeoptera to Polyneoptera, which can fold their wings, there's not a great difference in the origination and the extinction rates, nor for the Paraneoptera over the time period in which we have data for them. But the thing that really does strikingly come out is what's happening with the Holometabola. So these are the insects with metamorphosis down here at the bottom, and they have origination rates which are surprisingly low. Not significantly lower than the groups above them, but then they're not definitely very high. And what is noticeable and what is different is that they have extinction rates, this dotted line at the bottom, which is almost zero. And in fact, the extinction rate has never outweighed the origination rate across the geological stages for this group. So when we're trying to explain the very high richness of Holometabolan families, really the reason, we can't really imply that the reason is because they've got high origination rates. They haven't. But they do have almost zero extinction rates. So the last proximate factor we can really talk about is whether insects display a carrying capacity, or different groups might display carrying capacities that are different. Has the number of taxonomic groups or the number of species met a limit yet, which has maybe constrained the richness of insects, or is it likely to keep on growing? Well, fossils again can tell us something useful there. So in this top graph, here we see how the family level richness of insects varies in the fossil record, and the top line in that graph shows what you see if you just use the raw fossil record, and that suggests that the number of families is likely to continue increasing. It doesn't look as though it's met an upper limit yet. There's a problem with that upper graph, and the methods that have been used to construct it assume that for groups of insects which have a fossil record but which are still around today, that their ranges extend all the way from their first fossil all the way forwards to the present. And that's a rather unfair way of treating the fossil record, because you're using observations of present-day insects to imply their ranges for the groups that are still alive, but you can't do that for the groups that are extinct. So you're sort of implying a different data set, a source of data, when trying to construct the richness curves for the extinct and the still living groups. So a fairer way to assess richness through time is to only look at the fossil data, to ignore your knowledge of whether the groups are still living or not, and to just chart richness in the fossil record. And when you do that, then you find that there hasn't been a marked increase in the family level richness of insects since the time of the dinosaurs, the Cretaceous period here, about 120, 130 million years ago, implying that if you were to go back to that time, you would see about the same number of insect families on Earth as you do today. Another way of analyzing the richness of families through time is to use an ecological approach to take a fair sample of fossils at each stage during the geological past, and to compare the number of families in that fair sample. And this is necessary because the amount of data available in different geological stages actually varies a lot. So we want to try and standardize that, because there's more data available for recent geological periods than there is for more ancient geological periods. But when we use that fair sampling technique, we also find no strong evidence that richness has increased very much since this point in time, about 130, 140 million years ago. And you can see that the sort of variation through time in this graph matches pretty well the variation through time in that upper graph. So this fossil analysis suggests that the level of whole families, maybe there has been a fall off in the growth of the number of insect families, and maybe they have reached some kind of upper limit. But we can also do analyses on evolutionary trees of living insects, and we can analyze that at the species level if we incorporate our information on how species rich different groups of insects are today, because that implies that they must have been diversifying at a certain rate. And if you take an evolutionary tree of most of the living families of insects and add in information about how rich those families are, you can apply statistical models of evolution to those to estimate what you think is the most likely diversification rate of the insects through time. And this graph on the left shows the best fitting model to those data, which is for an increasing rate of diversification through time. And that implies that insects have not reached an upper limit on the carrying capacity of the planet for insects, and that more and more insects are going to evolve in the future at the species level. There's an interesting kink in that line here, and that coincides with the origin of beetles, and this is the diversification rate estimated using the same data just for the beetles, and you can see that they're estimated to have diversified initially at a much higher rate than the other insects, but that rate has dropped, and now on average beetles are not diversifying any faster than in the average insect. So that's rather interesting, because it suggests that the taxa of the future might not be the same as the groups of insects that have dominated the past. And you can see that on other evolutionary trees as well. So here's a tree of the true dragonflies. And again, what we've done here is we've applied statistical models to see what rates of speciation and extinction best explain the branching structure of that tree. And the rate of diversification along the branches is indicated by the color of the branches, with blue being low rates of diversification and red and yellow and green being higher rates of diversification. And you can see that that's very variable across groups. So there are some groups down here which have very low rates of diversification and they're not increasing. You can see other groups like this one, which have got higher rates, but those rates are actually decreasing over time. You can see up here at the top a group which has suddenly increased in its rate of diversification. So it's very variable, and here is a group which is gradually increasing its rate of diversification from blue through green through yellow. And the red dots on this picture show where the evolutionary model has predicted there would be a sudden shift in the rate of diversification at a point in time. So you can see again what this tells us is that the groups of insects that are going to dominate the future are going to be different to the ones that dominate the present or have dominated the past. So bringing together all that evidence on the approximate factors that might affect insect species richness, we can make a little summary. So we've shown that rich groups overall have higher overall diversification rates, so it appears that diversification rates at least need to be explained, and they differ across groups. So when we tease out what's contributing towards those diversification rates in the richest groups, we find that at least in fossil studies there's a low extinction rate, which is characteristic of the groups which have the highest number of families. But at the species level, it appears that a carrying capacity of species has not been met, and the future of insect life on Earth is going to be one in which there are more and more species evolving. But which species those are is going to vary in the future, so there's going to be this taxonomic replacement. So turning now to ultimate factors, one of the sets of ultimate factors that might be affecting all these proximate factors include morphological variables, and particularly people have suspected that the fact that some insects have wings and some insects display metamorphosis might explain why some of those groups have more species than both non-insect groups and the insects which don't have those characteristics. Well, I've just shown you a fossil study which addresses whether wings and metamorphosis might have been important, because remember, in the Paleoptera, which first evolved wings but which don't have some of these other subsequent key innovations like wing folding and metamorphosis, they have higher turnover rates, higher rates of origination and higher rates of extinction than their more basal relatives. So it could be that wings are responsible for that. And in the insects which gained metamorphosis, we remember we've shown a lower level of extinction at the level of the family. So those studies suggest that wings and metamorphosis might have been important in explaining species richness across groups. But you get a somewhat different picture from studies of evolutionary trees of living insects working at the species level. So here is an evolutionary tree of most of the insect families. There's about 850 of them in this one. And this was produced by James Rainford, a PhD student of mine. And again, we've applied statistical models of diversification to this tree. And you can see that there's the generic increase in diversification from blue to red through time that we talked about earlier. What you can see, however, is when wings evolved for the first time here, point P, there's no big shift in diversification rate, nor here at point H when metamorphosis first evolved. Where there are big shifts, increases in fact in diversification rate, they occur in the four big orders of insects which have metamorphosis, so butterflies and moths, flies, beetles, and the bees, ants, and wasps. And that doesn't mean that metamorphosis, or indeed wings, aren't important in the diversification rates of these groups. It just means that on their own they don't lead to big increases in diversification rate. If metamorphosis or wings are important, then they're only important in combination with other factors that must have evolved later on. So it's still possible that wings and metamorphosis are important, but on their own they don't guarantee high rates of diversification. So people have long suspected that other groups of variables, particularly morphological variables, might have explained the species richness of insects. In particular, people have wondered whether having a skeleton is something that's advantageous for insect diversification, whether they got vision and sophisticated nervous systems, and things about the way they interact with other organisms. Some of them are parasitic, for example. Whether they live on land or not, which insects do live on land, some of them are freshwater, there are very few that are marine, and that might be important. And also whether the two sexes appear in separate individuals, as they do in insects, but not in other organisms like many plants. Both sexes are expressed in one individual. Well, a statistical study has shown that in fact all of those five factors, you can see here in these different columns at the top right of the figure, are important in explaining the differences in species richness across the animal phyla. So here's an evolutionary tree of the different major body plans of animals. Just to orient you, insects are in this phylum here called Arthropoda, and they of course have got the greatest species richness of any phylum. And the phylum to which you belong, the Chordata, is up here, and they have a lower species richness. Most of the other animals on there are worms or worm-like organisms. And you can see here in red on these bars is the proportion of species in those different groups which have the characteristic which are labelled at the top of those columns. So what you can immediately see visually is where there's a lot of red in each row indicating each phylum of animals, then the more red you can see in those columns, then the higher the richness of the group. And these five characteristics together explain almost all of the variation in species richness across the animal phyla. And another thing you can notice is that there's only one phylum in which all of these five characteristics are true, and that's the Arthropoda. So this study is really interesting, and it suggests that arthropods and the insects which are a member of the arthropods are species rich, largely because they express all of these five characteristics in one group. People have long suspected that another morphological feature, the small size of insects, might have affected or improved their species richness. And the body size of insects varies a lot. The smallest insect here on the left is a representative of that group. These are parasites of other insect eggs. This is a wasp of the family Mimaridae. And some of those are less than a tenth of a millimeter long. Some of the largest insects in body length are the stick insects. And here's a species which is 2 feet from the tip of one leg to the tip of the other leg. Now the people have wondered for a long time as whether small-bodied insects, or indeed animals as a whole, have higher rates of diversification, which might explain why there are so many species of small insect. The proper way to test that is to take groups of insects which are the same age. We call these sister groups, which evolved from a shared common ancestor, and you can find the difference in the size of those two groups, which you call here the contrast in body length, and you can compare the species richness of those two groups, which we call here the contrast in species richness. And for lots of those sister pairs, you can plot whether the body length difference correlates with the species richness difference. And if diversification rates are higher in small-bodied insects, you'd expect a negative correlation on the data points on that graph. And you can see here for the hexapods as a whole and for the insects with metamorphosis, but it's true of all the groups of insects that we've studied, that there's no correlation whatsoever. Now, this might seem surprising because we do know that there are many more species of small-bodied insect than there are large-bodied insect. But it turns out that when you plot a frequency distribution of body sizes for insects, people have done this quite a lot, you find that that on a log scale they are what we call normally distributed. So on a log scale, most insects are about average sized. And that's the kind of distribution of body sizes you would expect to see if diversification rate didn't affect, if body size didn't affect diversification rate at all. And that's a consequence of the fact that for characteristics of insects or any organism that evolve on a continuous scale, something you can measure with a ruler, for example, then we expect them to evolve in what we call a proportionate fashion. So for a large insect, increasing its body length by 1 centimeter might be a relatively easy transition, but for a very tiny insect, increasing its body length by 1 centimeter is going to be less likely. And that what that will tend to do is it will tend to bunch up body sizes which are on the left of that graph, which are smaller, and naturally that's going to lead to more species of smaller insect. So this study and other studies have suggested that actually the reason why there are lots of small species of insect is not because they diversify faster than large-bodied insects, it's simply because body size evolves in a proportionate way. So the ecology of insects, the interactions between insects and their environment, might be important in explaining their species richness. And people have long suspected that interactions with other organisms are an important part of that. So we've already looked at parasitism and how that can affect species richness across animal phyla. And people have suspected that herbivory in the insects might also explain species richness across different groups of insects. And a basic understanding of why that might be comes from looking at how insects exploit plants. So there are lots of species of plants out there. Of course, there are more species of insects. But to an insect, a plant is a very large-bodied thing. And lots of different insects can exploit a single plant. And they can exploit it in different ways. So just to take a typical plant species, imagine an oak tree. An oak tree can be exploited by insects which burrow through the roots, or that live on the surface of the bark, or that eat the flowers of that tree, or eat the acorns of that tree, or that eat the young leaves in the spring, or that eat the old leaves in the autumn. And some of them can exploit the twigs, and some of them can exploit the lower branches, and so on. Then it's not surprising, once you think of it in that way, that each plant species can be inhabited by many, many different insect species. So a typical oak tree might have over 300 species of insects living on them. So there's a potential to divide up plants into lots of different resources that can be exploited by different insects. And when you, again, try to correlate the species richness and the diversification rate of the different main orders of insects shown here, and trying to explain them in terms of whether the groups are herbivorous or not, you find that it does explain a lot of that variation. So this right-hand graph shows you the total species richness of each order, and the green part of it shows you an estimate of how many of those species are actually herbivorous. And you can see that the green bits on the right-hand side of those graphs only largely occur in the bars which are very long, i.e. in the species-rich groups. So there is some evidence that, at least at the level of the order of insects, herbivory does explain and seems to increase diversification rate. However, not all studies agree with that. So if you look at the level of the family and you compare families or groups of families of insects which are either herbivorous or their sister clades that are not herbivorous, and you compare their species richness, you find that the species-rich groups are not always the herbivorous groups, and herbivory therefore doesn't explain species richness. So some studies disagree with this, and also people have conducted studies within the order, the beetle order Coleoptera, which you can see here, that's this bar here. You can see that although there are herbivorous plant-feeding Coleoptera, there are a greater number of species which don't feed on plants. And if you make the same study that I've just suggested but just within beetles, then you find that herbivory doesn't explain the different species richness of the different subgroups of beetles. So herbivory might sometimes promote diversification, but it doesn't appear to always do so. So another ecological interaction that might explain variation in the richness of insects might be interactions with the physical environment, and in particular people are interested here in how the climate, changing climate, might have affected insect diversity. Now there are reasons to suspect that climate change might affect insect diversity more than it might do for other groups, because insects interact a lot with other organisms, and when the climate changes, other organisms change their ranges. The ranges might become fragmented, or they might move up and down in latitude, and the insects that depend on those organisms might move with them and diversify or go extinct with them. So there's reasons to suspect that climate change might be particularly effective in modifying the diversification or the extinction of insects. And some studies suggest that this is indeed the case. So here's a fossil study. Now, earlier on I said that generally studies of the fossil record of insects occur at the family level, because at the family level we have greater completeness. So on rare occasions, though, you can study insects at the species level in the fossil record. In particular, you can do that when you don't actually study the insects themselves, but the traces they have left behind, because leaves of plants sometimes fossilize very well, and insects attack those leaves and leave traces of their attacks. So here, for example, is a fossil leaf in which an insect has mined and lived in that leaf and eaten out a part of the leaf and left a trace of its presence. And here's a fossil leaf where a bite has been taken out by an insect. We know that in modern day communities, the types of damage on leaves corresponds very well to the species richness of the insects that attack those leaves. And so it's likely that was also true back in the fossil record. So here what we have effectively is that the number of damaged types on fossil leaves can be indicative of the species richness of the insects that attack those leaves. And it turns out that in some sites you can study these damage attacks by insects over a number of millions of years, and it turns out that the number of damage types, which you can see here corresponding to the number of insect species attacking those plants, is positively correlated with the temperature at the time in which those insects were living, which is shown here on the x-axis. That's a measure of temperature, and you can see that temperature tends to positively correlate with the number of damage types or species of insects over time. And this study was conducted just after the extinction of the dinosaurs in North America. And that suggests maybe that this variation is due to the greater diversity of insects which occur in warmer climates. However, it doesn't always appear that warmer climates increase the diversification or the diversity of insects, because here's a study of a group of insects, the birdwing butterflies, which live in the Indo-Australian region, and particularly in the Indonesian archipelago. And these butterflies have diversified for a number of million years, about 25 million years, and we have an evolutionary tree of these butterflies that enables us to say how their diversification might be affected by the climate over which they've diversified. So this graph in the top left shows how global temperature appears to have changed during the history of this group And you can see on average it's gone down, so the world has got cooler. And as climate has cooled, so sea level has tended to drop as well. And it turns out that from correlating sea level and global temperature with the pattern of branching in the evolutionary tree of this group, we can infer that during warmer periods, the extinction rate of birdwing butterflies has been higher, you can see here, during the warmer periods. And that also coincides with a higher extinction rate when sea level was higher, as you can see there. And this kind of makes sense because during periods of high sea level, the islands which are inhabited by this group would have been flooded, the area of habitat would have got smaller, and that's likely to have increased the probability that these species would go extinct. So here we have a group of tropical species that actually does better in cooler climates, and that stands in contrast to the previous study in which those plant-feeding insects appears to have diversified or got more species-rich during warmer periods. So in general we can see that climate change does seem to have effects on insect diversification, but it might have different effects in different groups, and we don't currently know to what extent these effects are similar to the effects in other organisms. That still remains to be tested. So overall we can summarize some of those ultimate forces that we've studied. So there is conflicting evidence about the effect of wings and metamorphosis on insect diversification. And there's some evidence that they have positive effects, but not all the evidence is conclusive about that. We do know or have strong statistical studies that suggest that other features of the way insects are put together, their morphology and the way they interact with the environment and other organisms, those are important. So for example, their skeleton, their vision, the fact that they have separate sexes, those predict a higher richness. But it doesn't appear that smaller bodies increases, having a smaller body increases your rate of diversification. And then the ecology of insects appears to be important. So there's evidence, again not conclusive evidence, that herbivory is important, might not be important in all groups. Parasitism might be important. Living on land almost certainly is important. And we know that climate change also has affected the diversification of insects. So to sum up some broad messages from what I've just told you, I think we know in principle how to explain the species richness of insects, and some of the analyses I've shown do say something about that. It's important to note most of these studies were only possible recently because of developments in the underlying science base, so that's great. The data do support some of the ideas I've talked about quite well, but they don't support all of them, so some ideas are ideas we might want to throw out eventually. And the answer appears to be a complex one, and that's because what appears to be a simple question, why there's so many insect species, is actually, when you think about it, it's actually a complicated question. You can answer the question at different levels, and at each of those levels there are several different possibilities, not all of which are mutually exclusive. Unfortunately, we might not have a one-sentence answer to this question, we probably won't have. But that's nonetheless an interesting type of answer. It's important to remember that our tools are still far from ideal and probably always will be, although they will get better. And that means that the answers we have today might not be the answers that scientists in the future are telling you about. So this is a project, if you like, that might have to run and run as long as humanity exists. So it's not the kind of question to which we're going to have final answers. And I suppose that's an inevitable consequence of the challenges of studying a very diverse group. So a final thing to say is that I've really told you nothing about how the ultimate forces affect the proximate forces. They do so through some kind of population level effect. So individuals are going to be affected by the ultimate forces, and populations are going to split or go extinct. And I've not really said anything about how that happens. And really, the types of study that are going to address that are going to be very different kinds of study to the broad comparative statistical studies that I've been talking about. Finally, here are the references that I've referred to during this presentation. I do encourage you to go and read them to find out more about what these scientists have done. And please be aware that if you want to use any of the materials from these publications, then they may still be under copyright, so please check carefully with the original publishers before using them for any purposes.